In episode number 368 of the Reasons I'm Broke podcast, we cover the long-anticipated Birds of Prey trailer from Warner Brothers.
We also have some news about some changes that were made at the Joker movie's green carpet premiere.
Our comic book highlight this week is a finale with Batman TMNT number 6.
All of this and so much more on today's show.
Hello and welcome to your 2019 podcast awards winning Woo! The Reasons I'm Broke podcast. Third time was the charm. I am Camper Daniel this week.
And I am Emperor Palpakelli.
The Brokehead Core. We got to get this out of the way first off before we go into the news, because the podcast awards, we had been nominated because of the Brokehead Core, because of you, for the 2017 and 2018 podcast awards under Games and Hobbies. And for this year, the same winners over the last 2 years, Trivial Warfare was also nominated this year. And we actually ended up not only getting nominated for the third year in a row, but as you and many Brokettes said, third time was the charm. It was indeed. I think I was the least confident out of anyone, because people like Scott from Lazy Gaming Guys, he was like, no, you guys got it this year for sure. I just have a feeling. I know you guys are going to get it. And everyone else was like, yeah, of course they got it this year. All the listeners were so much more confident about it. I think it would have been a bigger upset to them if we did not come out on top. And it is insane. I still can't believe it. When this live stream was going on Podcast Awards, on International Podcast Day, and then our acceptance speech played. It was insane. Absolute insanity.
I certainly didn't expect it either. I was probably even less than you, because you're watching the live stream, right? And we were still further down the line, right? It was pretty early on. And I was like, I got to get ready for bed. And so I'm getting ready for bed, because I was like, we didn't even win. Like, I didn't want to be there to see your face when you were disappointed because we didn't win again. But then you busted in the room and it was playing our award, like our acceptance speech. And I was like, oh, shit.
It's just like Todd Cochran, who mainly headlines the podcast awards every year. As we always say, we're not sure why he does it, because there's a lot of work that goes into it. And he has a crew that does help him out with it. But for the most part, he really takes this by the horns and makes it happen each and every year. And much afterward, he deals with the fallout of, hey, I submitted my video, or is it too late to submit my video? And all the, every time you try to run and organize some kind of award show, it can get very dicey and tricky. And thankfully, Todd has the drive to do that every year and to host it. And I'm not, just like he said on the awards show, the way that it kind of breaks down is all the nominees have to submit an acceptance speech video. And then on the stream, that's when you find out if you ended up. So for the last 2 years, we submitted a video as well. But for this year, it actually played, and we had it, and we had it on there with a little backdrop with the new recording space that you helped put together, that you mainly put together here, especially with all the different graphics and tapestries. And it was just absolutely crazy that the chat on the stream was filled with Brokettes, which was awesome. I was watching. I had my Twitter and Instagram and texts blowing up from people just congratulating. And yes, they did it this year. And it was an overwhelming flood of positivity, congratulations, and overall celebration for the show.
So exactly like we said in our acceptance speech, the award is for all of you as much as it is for us. So thank you to all of our longtime Brokettes who have been listening for all these years. If you're brand new to the show, welcome to the show as well. We're happy to have you here. We're happy to hopefully live up to the name, right? To live up to this award. But this is also a milestone for us. It is our last show as well.
Yes, we will be retiring the if anyone had any heart attacks there.
Like car crashes everywhere. No. So the joke was we were just going to retire, right? We hit our high, oh, time to retire. But of course not. No, we are so thankful for this award and for winning. And now we just feel the motivation to live up to the name. I told Daniel we were sitting down to record. I'm like, there's so much pressure now.
Well, that's what something I was thinking about, because I was like, all right, so do we have this pressure to kind of deliver extra this week or moving forward or for the next year or whenever? And I'm like, no, I didn't feel any extra pressure because I'm constantly trying to be at that high peak of 100%, 110% of like, nope, not good enough. Keep going. Mm-hmm. Just keep building, keep grinding. And I'm still in that state in spite of the award show. And it's just like I said on Patreon. And now that we have, you know, unlimited time essentially on the show of, you know, not limited to 90 seconds, but yes, as you said, this was a win for you, for the listener, for the Brokehead Core, for everyone involved in the Reasons I'm Broke podcast. This is a win for everyone, but it is not the driving force to us keeping this going. The award show is not us going, oh, well, let's do this some more then. It is you guys, you being there on the other side, listening to this podcast, listening to this episode, interacting with us on Twitter, you taking the time to listen to the show every week, every month, every year, however long you have been on, we really appreciate it. And that's the fuel, that's the gas that keeps us going.
One of the coolest things about this award, though, is that we will actually be receiving a trophy as well. So when we do get that, of course, we're going to share it with you. It's yours as much as it is ours. So be looking for that on our Twitter.
Yeah, we'll be trying to put it up as many places as we can. Maybe YouTube, definitely Twitter, definitely Instagram and Facebook. So be on the lookout, as you said, for that. And I think the last thing that I have to say about the win is I've had a couple of Brokettes say, all right, time to focus on defending for next year. And one of the things I was joking of is let me just enjoy this for a second before I start stressing about defending for next year. And I don't even look at it as defending, really. It's a let us work to earn once again the nomination first, and then hope for a win. And last year's winner, Trivial Warfare, reached out to us and congratulated us as well, along with everyone else out there, some other shows that were in our category, and other shows that were in other categories on the podcast awards. I was going to take on the task of trying to copy and paste all the kind tweets, all the congratulatory texts and everything, but it was, while I feel like I could have done it, I feared that I would have missed one person and that would have been awful. So I just want to thank you, if you're listening, for that, taking that time for that amazing tweet or text or comment or Discord. All of that was very kind, very uplifting, and something that we've never experienced at this level. We get it, you know, in bits throughout the weeks or the days. But to get it all at once from all of the familiar listeners and from new listeners, it's something really special and something that I won't forget, and something that I hope you won't forget either, Kelly, or you, the listener.
So once again, we send out all of our thanks to you. But Daniel, let's get into the meat of our podcast, which is what actually won us our award. Not us just talking about how great we are, although I do that pretty frequently.
Well, you are the emperor.
I'm the emperor. I thought about doing like a Twitter series, like day in the life of your emperor and showing them all the cool things I do all day. But it seemed like a lot of work.
It'd be appreciated, though, if you ever decide to. So let's move forward with your 2019 podcast award winning The Reasons I'm Broke podcast. Let's kick it off with the news.
Starting off with some news that I was pretty disappointed about. According to Deadline, Marvel Studios and Sony's new Spider-Man deal will include a, quote, shared detail universe, end quote, where Spidey can cross over between the MCU and Sony's Venomverse.
So, of course, you've seen this all over the place. The two companies agreed to Sony's initial terms of upping box office to a 25% share as opposed to Disney's proposed 50%. Previously, it was 5% goes to Disney of box office, 95 of it goes to Sony because they were paying for the production of the movies. And instead, Disney, in return, they got the 5% of box office, but then they also got merchandising. So all the sales from the merchandising, which is pretty fucking huge. And now Disney said, well, we made this much money with these movies. It is less than what Sony made on Venom 1. They took in a larger profits earning. You can look up that Forbes article from Venom alone than that split earnings between Homecoming and Far From Home. So to Sony, they said, we don't have to agree to your 50%. Mm-hmm. You can fuck off. We'll up it to 25%, but we're not going to 50%. That's ridiculous. Turns out the two companies ended up, Disney came back and said, all right, 25% then.
Okay.
Disney is paying for 25% of production though. So that's something else that is a part of the deal. Mm-hmm. And right now they are set to have one more Spider-Man standalone movie and I believe two cameos. Might be one, but I believe I had read it was two. I didn't look into it too closely because Paul Pacelli and I will not be seeing, just like we didn't see Far From Home, the Iron Man Jr. movie that is inevitably coming or the Iron Man Jr. cameo because we are not watching any more MCU movies moving forward, especially after that Thor Ragnarok nonsense, plus most of the movies that came before it.
I haven't watched a Marvel movie since Doctor Strange. I don't know, that boring ass movie that I fell asleep during.
I'll tell you the one Marvel movie we did see doesn't count though as MCU. It is Venom and we're going to be there for Venom 2.
It's Venom.
So one thing we, if this deal is legit and they are actually talking about having this Tom Holland Spider-Man in the Venom universe, then we might see Iron Man Jr. pop up. It'll probably be the worst part of that movie, but you know, it is what it is. This is what the way Disney handled the least Spider-Man of all time.
Tom Holland is my least favorite Spider-Man. He always has been.
That's crazy because I know you really didn't like Tobey Maguire. I thought Tobey Maguire was your least.
No, I like him more now than I like Tom Holland, but like the other guy is still my favorite. Andrew Garfield.
Yeah.
Still my favorite.
Andrew Garfield's and Tobey Maguire's Spider-Man's were much closer and much more accurate depictions of Spider-Man, especially when compared to the comic books. Mm-hmm. The MCU has Disney-fied him and made him almost as fucking jokey as Deadpool. It's absolutely ridiculous. And I know some people do argue that Spider-Man is a jokey character. It's absolutely overblown with the way Disney has done it, with all of the... You even watch his appearance in Civil War. It's crazy. You guys see that old movie about the thingy and the, oh, you got a metal arm and it's, what the fuck is this? Peter Parker is very grounded in the way that he does take on his persona as Spider-Man. It's a lot of internal struggles and inner turmoil that goes into putting on that mask, especially with the death of Uncle Ben and trying to protect all of the people he loves. It's a constant inner struggle that when he does occasionally quip with the villains, that's to deal with the stress of the situation he's in. You watch Spider-Verse as that Peter Parker, the first Peter Parker is dying in Miles' universe. Even then, he doesn't joke nearly as often as the MCU one, does it more on par with the comics. And when he tells when he's talking to Miles in a little bit of a lighter tone, not joking, but in a lighter tone of, yeah, yeah, I'm just resting, kid. He knows he's going to die. That's why he talks in this way. He is trying to raise the situation or at least try to rise above it in some way, which the MCU has absolutely missed. Your opinions on this?
Well, I was just enjoying psychologist Daniel giving us the inner workings.
And I'm not
of
even
these
a fucking huge Spider-Man fan. That's what's crazy.
I can't say that I've seen enough of him as Spider-Man to, I mean, really hone in on how much he jokes. I'm sure that he does it all the time, right? Because everybody says that he does it. I don't like him as Spider-Man. I don't think there needs to be another movie with him as Spider-Man. But whatever. Like, that's what the people want. And they worked out a deal. And hopefully Sony makes money. But probably still nobody's going to go to see it. So,
well, they're going to do well in the box office. And that's the main reason why they're doing this. But I do
think...
As
well as Venom?
No, they're not going to make as much as what they've done with Venom. And the last two movies have proven that. And I think they would have gone the better route of doing an older Spider-Man as people were rumoring and talking about to match Tom Hardy's Venom, which would have been really interesting because it would have been a more seasoned Spider-Man, which we haven't yet seen on the big screen aside from Spider-Verse. I'm talking live action, but hopefully we'll see that in the near future. Maybe they still decide not to use this Iron Man Jr. kid in the Venomverse.
Awesome.
Venom can clearly stand on his own. The first movie has proven that, so it'll be very interesting to see what Sony decides to do. And to the MCU sheep that have been saying, well, this deal, as soon as it's over, Disney will end up buying Sony anyway, so it doesn't matter. As DC Olympus pointed out, Sony, if you look at their profits, if you looked at the size of the company, Sony is 3 times larger than Disney. Disney could never buy Sony.
No.
Pretty fucking ridiculous. Let's move on over to the DC side of today's news, and there's a lot of it. As mentioned in the opening, the Birds of Prey and the Fantabulous Emancipation of One Harley Quinn trailer dropped.
You know what a Harley Quinn is? A Harley Quinn's role is to serve. It's nothing without a master. No one gives two shits who we are beyond that.
We saw a lot in this trailer and a lot of Harley Quinn in this trailer. Mm-hmm. And all the people out there who were saying it was too much Harley, Harley sells. So that's why it was all Harley.
People have to remember that this trailer is not to the comic book reader. It's not to the DC fan. This is for the general audience. And guess who are they're fucking familiar with?
Harley Quinn.
Especially after Suicide Squad.
And Obi-Wan Kenobi.
You got a lot of Ewan McGregor in there, absolutely. And those were probably the two largest bits of that trailer. Margot Robbie is a massive fucking name. She just came out of Once Upon a Time in Hollywood, did an amazing job there. And even before then, she's been in Academy Award-nominated movies. She is one of the biggest actors out there right now, and why not put her on that forefront, not only for the general audience, but for people that actually watch these fucking movies? You put Huntress or Black Canary on there, you think that's going to sell the fucking movie? Harley Quinn is the most colorful bit of that group, and later on in trailer 2, 3, maybe we'll get a little bit more of the different characters, but they got to hook you in first, and that is with Harleen Quinzel, who is the most popular of this group. I know the Black Canary fans are very rabid out there, but guess what? Your numbers are not as large as Harley. I'm sorry. That's the truth. You may be very vocal. You may be loud. You may be very passionate. We used to be very passionate as well when Harley Quinn wasn't as big as this. And I feel you, but you gotta realize that this is what is going to sell, and it is Harley Quinn.
I would argue, though, that Black Canary was the third most featured character in that trailer, though, and at least, you know, more recognizable than some of the other ones, like Huntress, who we saw briefly, and who was it, Montoya?
Yeah, Renee Montoya.
Yeah, she was in there as well. But again, very briefly, it mainly focused on Harley, exactly like you said. That's what's going to pull in audiences. They made her extremely colorful in this, too. Like, everywhere you look, she was in something crazy and frilly and colorful, and it really drew you in, and I feel revved up excitement for a lot of people.
I was watching a trailer breakdown from Insider, and there were a lot of very interesting things that were caught that unless you pause the trailer, you will not see. And one of the first one I want to touch on, because you know you and I are big Harley Quinn fans
before
from back in the animated
cool.
series. Well, yeah. What are we, hipsters? From the animated series, yes, Harley Quinn, her first appearance, and later on she made it into comics, and now she's on the fucking big screen. But we were both, and you in particular, were a very big fan of this change in the relationship between Joker and Harley Quinn in Suicide Squad, where it did seem like this Joker, Jared Leto's, legitimately cared about Harley Quinn, and there was actual love there, which I pointed out there in the review, is different than what we've seen in the past. Like, you see it from her point of view and you almost believe it as her, but in this case it almost seemed like the Joker actually did care about the safety of Harley Quinn, constantly trying to save her. He didn't have to. He could have left her and left, and she would have eventually found them, and they would have been together again, but not in this iteration. However, in Birds of Prey, they end up making it very clear that the Joker and Harley have broken up. She's her own person. They build on that with her having clothing that all say Harley Quinn on it. And no longer does it say Daddy's Little Monster. So how do you feel about that departure from the Joker and from what we're clearly not going to see of Jared Leto's Joker? There's a stunt double that they're going to use, but Jared had said he is not in this movie.
This is a theme that we've seen much more from Harley and from her stories throughout recent years where she's stepping away from the Joker and becoming her own person. We talked about it last week in the Harley Quinn comic book, right? Where she's this very successful person without the Joker prior to, goes crazy, falls in love with him, right? But there's nothing saying that she can't be successful without him again. Do I like her best when she's with him? Yes, because the two of them have such a great dynamic. But if the story is told right, if she's with other characters that support her as well and she can support them and they all become better people at the end, cool. Do I think at some point she's going to be like, I'm going to go back to the Joker, bye. Probably, because again, that's who Harley Quinn is. But it's not uncommon at this point for her to step away and to do her own thing with her girls, with her band of other people who are like her, and then eventually make her way back to the Joker.
One of the things that was pointed out in this insider video is that you see her blowing up Ace Chemicals, and that symbolizes her departure and her full breakup from the Joker. And that's where they were created. That's where they really cemented themselves, I think, for life as Harley Quinn and Joker. And while she is making this breakaway, you mentioned that, yeah, probably down the line we'll see them back together. And I think you and I want to see that resolution of Harley and Joker once again. I'm curious to see what causes the breakup between the two characters. They might fall back on the comics of him just being an abusive boyfriend, I guess is what you want to call him. I don't know what you really... Can you really label the Joker in Harley's relationship?
I don't think it's out of line for maybe they say he was just angry one day, right? And they got in a fight or something stupid. I mean, yeah, okay, sure, going back to the abusive thing. Probably, if I had to guess, that would be what happens.
The other Batman the Animated Series debut of a character was one of the hyenas.
Yes!
Which showed up. I was so fucking happy. I first saw them in the promotional poster, and I thought it was great. I could have sworn there were two, but I guess there was only one. And maybe by the end, we'll get the two. But even if we get the one, that is such a cool inclusion to this. Something that I did not expect to see in this more realistic take on these characters.
If you had told me like 10 years ago, this is what we were going to get, I wouldn't even believe you. I'd be like, stop with your fairy tales. But yes, I love that they're throwing that in there too. It seems, it feels, I hope, like there's going to be a lot of nods to who Harley started out as, right? So if you're a longtime fan, you're going to see a lot of things from Paul Dini and Bruce Timm and what they built into the character and what she's grown into now, which is so exciting. I say it all the time, it's a great time to be a Harley fan, right? Mm-hmm. And to see how much she's grown, but to still see that in so many ways she's still being taken care of and they're not butchering the character to meet their needs. They're still leaving her as the fun individual that she is.
You also see a sequence, a musical sequence, which is an homage to Marilyn Monroe. And it's recreated through Margot Robbie and then a bunch of black mask dancers. You see dancers with that black mask. It is in Ewan McGregor's club, Roman Sionis. And in that same club, you do see Dinah Lance also performing in that. And then they meet up in the bar. And I'm guessing that's how they end up making their first connection in it. But yeah, let's move into Ewan McGregor's character of Roman Sionis. A lot of people are pointing out that you don't see him in his mask. And how come you don't see black mask? It's only the first trailer. DC Olympus once again pointed out that BVS's trailer showed Doomsday, people bitched. They didn't show Black Mask here, people bitched.
Of course. People are always going to be upset There's no winning. But I also have to wonder, how much do I really think that he's in the mask?
Oh, yeah. You pay Ewan McGregor, you don't put him in the mask
no,
that often.
No, I mean, unless he is a candelabra, but...
It might go the route of the comics where by the end of it, it'll get permanently, you know, burned into his face. Who knows?
I would really guess for at least 75% of the movie, you're going to see Ewan McGregor's face. And very briefly, you're going to see him in the black mask because I would guess, I don't know, right? I'm throwing stuff out, but maybe he's not fully developed as this villain until he starts running into Harley, which is what Harley does to a lot of people. They start out as kind of normal and then she turns him crazy too.
He does have several lines in there of Harley Quinn is mine, I need her, and so on. And then you see some cuts of him just breaking down and having some kind of breakdown with the camera. Like you get this angle of just him looking at you and losing it. So it's interesting to see what connection they both have or are going to have in Birds of Prey. I also thought that let's talk about the camera work and the way that they actually ended up breaking down the trailer, where it is very dynamic. There's some car chase sequences. There is a lot of shots, at least, of the crew eventually together and mm-hmm. fighting what I'm assuming is going to be Black Mask's group of henchmen. Did you feel that this was a little bit different than your standard, not only superhero movie, but even comic book based film?
I think I felt it was different from all of those things, though. The way it was set up just felt like a crazy ride from beginning to end, which is ultimately what this movie is going to be if you have Harley Quinn in it, right? It's just going to be absolutely crazy and her going through all these different things. But they showed, I feel like usually trailers kind of start at the beginning and lead you through a little story. And then there's, you know, that rise, beginning, middle, end, all that kind of stuff. But it was just crazy from the beginning. The whole thing, which I think is very much the tone of the movie that they're going with.
The final bit that I have to say about this first Birds of Prey trailer, and I'm sure we'll get more story elements with the next one, is that Margot Robbie originally, I don't know if you remember, but we, along with a lot of everyone else out there, reported that there was a solo Harley Quinn movie in the works, mm-hmm. and there was also a solo Joker Harley movie in the mm-hmm. works, along with Suicide Squad 2. But with the changes in everything, with Geoff Johns gone and Warner Brothers hitting the panic button after BVS, it just absolutely changed all the plans moving forward for everything. And it became clear with interviews with Margot Robbie, where she said, yeah, the plan was originally to have a solo Harley Quinn film, but I wanted to include more characters and other female characters in the DC universe in my movie. So she decided she's a producer mm-hmm. along with everyone else at Warner Brothers to make this about more than just Harley Quinn, but making it about other characters. So to anyone bitching that they only showed Harley Quinn, this started out as a Harley Quinn film. That is the base of this movie. You got to realize that when you're talking and looking and discussing Birds of Prey, is for all intents and purposes, this really is a Harley Quinn film. Because one, it sells. Two, it was originally a solo Harley Quinn film. But three, Margot wanted to expand it mm-hmm. to include more actors and more characters, which is great. And hopefully, you know, the end product ends up supporting that and ends up being a solid flick.
It will. You got Harley Quinn. You got Margot Robbie. She has done a fantastic job with this character, especially in Suicide Squad, right? Where we've seen her, of course. And this already looks like it's going to be great. We're sold. You don't have to tell us to go see it because we're already going to be there.
Birds of Prey and the Fantabulous Emancipation of One Harley Quinn is out in about 4.5 months on February 7th, 2020. And we will have a review for you right here.
Something that won't take another 4.5 months to get here because it's here, Daniel. It's here.
Pretty much, yeah.
It's like,
love it.
Like 24 hours from now, maybe.
By the time we're recording, yeah.
Something like that. Okay. Anyway, the Joker movie is here. It doesn't even feel like it. Like, okay, so which is more exciting for you, winning this award or the Joker movie?
Well, winning the award feels unreal to me. The Joker movie, I know I'm going to see, so there is anticipation. If I had known we were going to win, there would have been anticipation. I didn't know. Scott apparently did, and all the other Broquettes did. But
did you ask Scott about more things in the future? Because apparently,
I got to ask him.
He's a psychic.
He's either a psychic or some kind of master hacker. He rigged the results.
Shh, don't say that, they'll take it away. So there's been a lot of controversy over this film. We've talked about it almost every single week for a while now. But during the red carpet premiere of the Joker movie, Warner Brothers had disinvited journalists and only allowed photographers.
Good on Warner Brothers growing some fucking balls and avoiding what probably would have been a shitty PR situation. Mm-hmm. A Warner Brothers spokesperson said, quote, "Our red carpet is comprised of photographers only. A lot has been said about Joker, and we just feel it's time for people to see the film," end quote.
Good. That's exactly what it should be. Journalists are going out of their way to just kind of be nasty about
sabotage it.
And play it off as a joke, right? Oh, I'm just going to make this joke, but this is all about mental health. You're making a joke about that. You're making a joke about things that are very real for a lot of people. And because it makes you uncomfortable, you're writing it mm-hmm. off as okay.
You saw the Kimmel interview with
Joaquin.
Yeah,
it was not No. How can you call yourself a professional and do that?
I understand that this might be Jimmy's MO. He's always been more on edge with his comedy. He was one of the hosts on The Man Show many years ago. And I don't watch Jimmy Kimmel. It's not something we don't have cable, and it's not someone that I really mm-hmm. follow or had any interest in watching as an interviewer. But as we're watching this clip, because I saw it was trending on Twitter, where Joaquin's method acting was much like Heath Ledger's, much like Jared Leto's, much like Christian Bale's, followed that pattern of, yeah, you're going to end up snapping. You're going to snap back at other actors and people that might not be taking it as seriously. We also had Sir Patrick Stewart on Star Trek, The Next Generation. He's not a method actor, but he's a theater actor. So when he saw people not as disciplined as he would chastise his fellow members for not arriving on time, not showing up for the rehearsals. And he's like, no, the work has to get done. And that's the same mentality that Joaquin was having in this clip of, I got to get in this place and you guys are whispering and all this. And now this guy's calling me Cher because he's calling me a diva and all this other stuff. And they sprung this on Joaquin during the Jimmy Kimmel Show. So it goes back to what you're saying of, they're making light of someone and a movie that is about mental health. It's about someone breaking down. It's about absolute terror of this character, and it's a further confirmation of this sabotaging, or at least attempts to sabotage this movie. As we said before, the reviews didn't work. It still has a positive rating. As much as we don't listen to Rotten Tomatoes, mm-hmm. these sheep do. That did not work. So instead they went to the Guns Across America, or whatever that gun control group was called. And that went down, and that has actually worked. So congratulations, Disney, and fuck you, because I have had nothing but repeated regulars at the store saying, you know, I don't know. I don't know what these crazy people are going to do. I think I'm just going to wait for it. It is actually working. It is working. People are legitimately afraid of going to watch this movie because they think that they are going to get shot, or that there's going to be a similar situation as the Aurora shooting, which, as we pointed out last week, has nothing to do not only with this movie, but with even the Joker character. We and the FBI and everyone involved in that original case debunked this years ago. Mm-hmm. It's absolutely ridiculous, but terror works. So that's the one bit that Disney has gotten people on. It is getting people to worry. Some of my regulars were saying, well, I'm going to watch it next week instead. I'm going to wait just a bit until things slow down. I'm going to watch it on a Monday morning when there's not a lot of people there. People are afraid, and it's really bizarre. But, you know, so be it. If you're one of those people that are on the edge, like, I don't know if I'm going to see it because something might happen. It's like, what happened to, you know, don't let terror win. Don't let someone's actions. You are now lending weight to anyone that has ever caused harm to someone in a theater or in a public place or through a public shooting. You're lending weight to that, and you're letting that affect mm-hmm. your regular life. Don't let them win in that way. Don't let them affect how you live your life, how you want to do things.
This topic is so deep and so much that you could go into on it, right? The people who are saying, well, I'm not going to see it because of the shooting, part of it's because they're scared. Part of it's because, oh, well, maybe I need to justify not wanting to see this movie, right? Because I'm usually a Marvel sheep. But additionally, if you're really that scared about that, these things can happen anywhere. We see yes. it all the time now, right? You go to Walmart and it happens. It's happening in our schools. So if you're that scared to go to a movie because these things might happen, then why aren't you on board with any organization who can get things done? Mm-hmm. Why aren't you calling your representatives and saying, I'm scared to go to a movie, change laws?
There were, at the time, you know, by the time this comes out, there's undercover NYPD feds in theaters. You were joking that they just want to see the movie for free. And, you know, that's a good way to spin this. Like, really, they just want to see the movie. But you're right. You're more likely to get shot driving to work. Mm-hmm. More people get shot in cars than in movie theaters. So if that's really your concern, don't play the odds. Don't drive to work. Stay at home. And more people get shot at home. So don't stay at home. Let's see. Where do
Walmart?
People not get shot?
Oh, where do
no,
they
yeah,
not?
No, yeah, no. People get shot at Walmart. Uh-huh. I think the movie theater. Not a lot of people actually really get shot there. So that might actually be the safest place. Jesus. But again, Disney won this time. They got that. We're going to find out what the box office dictates and if that was truly enough to make this an issue for them, but...
But it's not, because it's still blowing up on my Facebook, right? I have so many friends who are say they're going to see it. We're talking about it at work, and a bunch of the MCU sheep are also saying they're excited to go see this
movie. Not
going to
like it. I'm telling you.
Maybe not, but they're excited to go see it. So, yeah, I don't think... You're hearing it here and there. I think at the end of the day, people are going to wake up and they're going to see all the positive hype and they're going to say, you know what? I'm just going to go see it.
Did you like, by the way, that they changed it from a red carpet premiere to a green carpet?
Yeah. Yes. That's
Jason
amazing.
Momoa came out. He went to the premiere. Yeah. He wore like an all green and purple outfit.
Good for him.
It was awesome. He had like the custom shoes done and everything.
Did he have his dad bod still? Or is he back to like being fit?
No, he's got his dad bod, because I don't think he has a movie on the horizon that requires him to be in that kind of shape. He just has to be in good shape, which he already is.
Keeping on with news of the Joker, though, we did have an interview with Vanity Fair where director Todd Phillips spoke about why he went from making comedies to a serious, grounded film like The Joker.
Poor Todd Phillips got dragged on Twitter for this interview. Let's go ahead and read the quote first. It is, quote, "Go try to be funny nowadays with this woke culture. There were articles written about why comedies don't work anymore. I'll tell you why. Because all the fucking funny guys are like, fuck this shit, because I don't want to offend you. It's hard to argue with 30 million people on Twitter. You just can't do it, right? So you just go, I'm out," end quote.
Thor Ragnarok director Taika Waititi.
However you say that shit.
Taffiti.
I could have looked it up. I didn't respect him enough to really, like Jen was telling me, my coworker, she's like, I don't think that's how you say the last name. I'm like, who cares?
Who cares? Anyway, the director was quoted on the article on Twitter saying, LOL, he funny.
And all the Marvel sheep immediately jumped to Taika's support of, yeah, drag Todd Phillips. That's right. He doesn't even know. If you can make a funny movie, then why can't he? And he's just mad because he can't offend people. And I'm like, one, Taika has not made a funny movie. Did you see Thor Ragnarok? It was fucking shit. It was an embarrassment. It was the second worst MCU movie they've ever fucking done. It was terrible.
What was the worst?
Hulk, Avengers 1.
Oh, okay.
Holy shit. Fucking Joss Whedon? He destroyed that goddamn shit. Somehow Avengers 2 was a little bit better. Goddamn, Avengers 1 sucked. They made an embarrassment out of Captain America in that first Avengers. Mm-hmm. And that was the character that I was really attached to, because Captain America 1 is my favorite MCU movie. It's directed by the same director that did The Rocketeer, which was a beloved childhood movie of mine. And he brought that magic to Captain America 1. Great, great movie. But of course, Joss Whedon, as he did with Justice League, ended up perverting the fucking Captain America that they built up to this point. And it's like, Jesus Christ, that was awful. Yes, Thor Ragnarok was another piece of shit. Did not laugh once watching that garbage. So as soon as you make a fucking comedy, then you can talk about what's funny, Taika. And another thing, as soon as you make a movie on par of quality with what seems to be The Joker, again, we're recording this before we watch it, but it's won the Golden Lion Award. People are raving. Even MCU sheep reviewers, some of them are going, well, I can't fucking argue. This was a good fucking movie. The performance was great. When you make a movie like Todd Phillips, then you can fucking talk, Taika. Because fuck yourself, you're making movies for producers. You're not making it for yourself. You're not an artistic director under the MCU. They're telling you what to film. And anyone that's like, what? I'm confused, huh? Look at the director that was about to direct the Black Widow movie. And they told her, yeah, you just direct these other scenes. We're going to take care of all of the action. We're going to take care of all of this. We're going to have other people working on that. You're going to take care of the dialogue and these scenes. These movies are not directed by the directors, everyone. Wake up and learn more about how these shitty fucking MCU... This is why they're shitty. This is why they're cookie cutter. Mm-hmm. This is why they're all the same fucking shit.
I can't follow up with that. How do you...
you can say, fuck you, Taika.
Yeah, fuck you, Taika Taffiti.
He only wishes he could make a fucking movie like Joker. And it's a shame that he drags another director when he's not truly directing under the MCU.
I think it's really interesting, though, that Todd Phillips points out, like, you can't argue with 30 million people.
Oh, that's true.
Right?
Yeah, let's talk about that point.
Moving on from Taffiti. So you can't argue with 30 million people, but he still wanted to make this Joker movie, right? So I think that goes to show how much this film is him and his vision and what he really, really wanted to do, because he wasn't trying to entertain a bunch of people. He was just trying to tell an amazing story. Mm-hmm. And obviously from the reviews that we've seen, it appears that he's done that.
Well, fuck reviewers. But right. By winning a Golden Lion, you're looking at film festivals. Like, this mm-hmm. is separate from... Film festivals are like, fuck you, Rotten Tomatoes. It has nothing to do with Rotten Tomatoes or any of that bullshit. Film festivals, you win shit. You win the Golden Lion. It ends up reflecting, according to history, from what we've seen in the past, Academy Awards and other award shows as well. So let's be real about this. It's ridiculous. And as soon as Taika gets a fucking Golden Lion...
You're going back to Taika. Let's talk about arguing with 30 million people.
Woke culture. Do you think it's... Why is it harder now to make a comedy, to be a stand-up comedian, than it was 20 years ago, 10 years ago, 5 years ago?
I feel like we've touched on this before when these kind of topics come up, but it's so easy to argue now. It's so easy to have your voice out there on the internet from behind your computer screen, and nobody can really attack you back, right? Yeah, they may type something out to you, but your friends don't know. Your friends aren't criticizing you. Like, people... In your everyday life, you keep those thoughts to yourself, but when it's somebody else, it's so easy to criticize to make you feel better, or you're going to say that you're offended. I don't want to say that people are easily offended, because that's not what I'm trying to make. Like, shitty things get said to people all the time, mm-hmm. and they have the right to be offended. But again, going back to how easy it is on the internet, people say things without thinking, and then that leads to offending other people. And then they're like, well, you're just easily offended. And it's a never-ending cycle.
Yeah, I think it goes to the, I might be wrong, I have no experience in this, but it's in the cancel culture portion of it, where I think before, we've had voices on the internet for years now, mm-hmm. but there was this change, I think it is in the last 5 years, of they said this, so cancel their project, make sure to fire them on this, yeah. make sure that doesn't happen anymore, whereas before it would be, I'm not watching that thing. I'm just not going to support it, mm-hmm. which I think is the balanced, rational approach. When I don't like something, I stop going there. I don't like the food, I stop going there. If I didn't like that movie, I'll never watch it again. And then it connects to the directors or actors or whatever. Like, nah, I didn't like their last movie. I think I'll pass. It's not for me. The MCU, not for me. They put out shitty product, great. But to go... This director or this comedian should never work on this again. Louis C.K. had that big mm-hmm. debacle, and he's one of my favorite comedians. And even now, like, he tried to come back from this controversy of sometimes it's like, hey, why was he canceled for this? Like, there wasn't a lot of this is dubious, and it's all because of that trending cancel culture that I think we're seeing. So I think Todd is just saying, I don't want to take that risk. Mm-hmm. And thankfully he didn't, because now we get Joker.
Something else that we're seeing a lot of, too, is people are chiming in on things that they wouldn't even partake in, right? So, again, going back to that thing with Louis C.K., how many people are criticizing him who have never seen any of his stuff?
Right.
They just read one article because it's trending, and they say, yeah, fuck him. And they don't realize the ramifications of these things. You are ruining people's lives. Mm-hmm. And, yes, granted, a lot of times people do shitty things, right? And they should be held accountable for those, but not always to the degree with which they are held accountable. Not to say that they should do things that Louis C.K. did, right? Well, that was my example.
I mean, I think a better example would be like Harvey Weinstein or something, but to Louis C.K. is just because it's my favorite comedian. I'm like, just give me more material. Like, I love that guy. He's great. And he did not do anything as egregious as any of these other people. Mm-hmm. It's insane. So, but yeah, I do see why Todd would choose instead to go this direction, but to drag him for it is absolutely ridiculous. And I think it goes back to that campaign of trying to do as much as possible to hurt this Joker film.
Regardless, we will still be there with our butts in the seat. First showing, opening day. You knew we were going to be there.
You'll have a review on the next episode.
We will have a review. But that's not all the Joker that we're getting. He's not just on the big screen, but we're also getting more of him in the comic books as well.
DC Comics has made, and as a retailer, I am thrilled. It wasn't necessary, though, but has made Joker Killer Smile number one returnable, as well as Dark Multiverse Death of Superman, which is a one-shot That's the one in which Lois Lane loses it. She probably becomes a villain from the Dark Multiverse arc of it after Superman's death. The death of Superman, one of the biggest comic books of all time. Both of those comics are returnable. Now, Joker Killer Smile was made returnable by a certain incentive. You have to order X amount of this issue based on a previous issue, which Marvel normally does, but on a silly fucking point of like this random issue. But DC's was easily attainable because a lot of people have pre-ordered Joker Killer Smile, where I'm like, even if I were to order non-returnable, I would have hit the incentive anyway. So I was like, hell yeah, then I'll fucking order 20 extra copies and I'll return the extras. Thankfully, more and more people are still like, hey, do I have that Killer Smile? Do I have Joker, Harley, Criminal Insanity also? And all of that has been helping. Mm-hmm. And thankfully, DC has been playing ball along with independent publishers of make that number one returnable. And they have, and it's going to help. And I love it. All Joker all the way. Why more Joker? Because as Harley Quinn in Birds of Prey, it sells. My subs have shown that. My pre-orders have shown that.
I'm excited for both of these. Lois Lane going crazy is such a great concept. We definitely won't be returning either of our copies.
Hell no.
Hell no.
But continuing down the comic book path, our buddy, Geoff Johns, unfortunately had to step down as CCO of DC Comics. But because of this, we're now seeing that the continuity of Doomsday Clock has become a lot lighter. I don't know if you've noticed that as you were... Are you reading Doomsday Clock right now?
I am. It's starting to lose me.
I think it is because of that. The ramifications are not as heavy as they were originally solicited. So it is because, as speculated, that Geoff Johns no longer having a heavy role and the DC Universe going in the direction of what happens in Doomsday Clock is going to affect all of these comics. Mm-hmm. He's no longer in control. I think they're instead trying to go with a looser approach of, all right, let's build this Bendis portion over here. Let's do the City of Bane over here. Let's no longer focus on the button over here. So now Doomsday Clock, unfortunately, is not that event that we were hoping for when Doomsday Clock number one, when the button happened with Flashpoint, all of that stuff was amazing. It looks like, unfortunately, it is going in a whole different direction.
I feel they just didn't maintain their momentum with that comic book. Like, I feel like we've been reading it for years.
Well, people are saying that maybe it wasn't delays from Gary Frank or Jeff, but it was the fact that he was getting demoted that they then had to shift all of the plans to make this non-relevant. Mm-hmm. Whereas originally they said this story takes place a year from now. So by the time the comics catch up, which was supposed to be 12 issues, then we will catch up to these events of Doomsday Clock. Clearly, that's not the case anymore. And because of this, readers have asked if the also Geoff Johns written The Three Jokers comic book was going to be in continuity. They asked the artist, who is Jason Fabok, if this now DC Black Label comic book is going to matter. I don't know, I hate saying that, but are the Three Jokers going to show up in other comic books outside of this?
I think Jason's quote is pretty fantastic. He said, quote, "It's in continuity like Killing Joke is. You can take it or leave it. We are going to introduce some pretty gutsy stuff in Jokers that's never been done before. So the fans can react to it and they can decide if they want it to be main part of the continuity or not. Like Killing Joke," end quote.
Killing Joke was originally a non-continuity comic book, what would have been probably a DC Black Label comic today, and the popularity of it, it resonated really heavily with readers. They ended up making it a big part of continuity. Batgirl, Barbara Gordon ended up becoming Oracle, healed from it in Gail Simone's New 52 Batgirl series. So all of that still continued and was awesome, and it is a huge part of the Batman universe lore, not only in Batman, but also DC Comics. And now we're going to see that loosely inspired by the Killing Joke also on Joker in the big screen. So I think he's going, well, it depends on you guys. If you guys read it and you love it and you demand more, then maybe we'll get more of it in DC in the other comic books. But I think it'll be a while, even if it is wildly successful, which it will be because it's the Three Jokers in itself, that we'll see the fallout of this particular miniseries.
I do really like this quote, though, and I feel it kind of all boils down to vote with your dollar, right? If you really like it, you're not only going to buy the issues, you're going to buy a trade paperback, you're going to tell all your friends about it, you're going to continue to get this momentum to get it to where you want to go. And if not, if you don't really like it, then you say, well, that was a great story. I'm going to leave that over here. And this is still my Joker. This is still my Batman universe.
Jason also hinted that the comic book, the miniseries, will mainly focus on Batman, Barbara Gordon, and Jason Todd.
How interesting.
Three characters, three Jokers. Do you think that the Barbara Gordon was shot by a different Joker, Jason Todd was killed by another different Joker, and then Batman has been dealing with a third one the whole time?
I would definitely lean towards that and agree with that.
So far, the three Jokers has not been given a release date, but it's looking like number one won't launch until 2020.
While we're excited about this book, not everybody is. Would you believe that in this age of the internet? Not everyone is excited about this comic book.
That's right. And longtime Brokettes know that this is the return of a little segment we haven't done in a little while.
It's been a long time.
But it is where we pick out an irrational, crazy, nonsensical quote. We will not give you the name of who it is. You can go ahead and dig it up yourself if you really want to. But it is our Nerd Rage Ratchet!
Oh, I ran out of breath. I can't do that like I used to. Oh, too old.
It's been that much. Yeah, it's been that long.
How did I used to be able to do that? Oh my God, I'm so tired. Oh, too much coffee or something.
So here we have a quote on this news story reading.
Where do I cast my vote against it? Such a stupid concept. The three Jokers cheapens the value of an individual if there is more than one version of him, because it cheapens the conflict of Batman and the Joker and Batman's responsibility for his creation. What? He let him fall into the acid three times? Me.
End quote. That's right. Three times. Yeah, that's what happened.
No,
all three were, they fell.
But you want to know where you can cast your vote besides up your ass? Don't buy the book. Oh.
Don't buy the goddamn comic. Also,
don't buy it.
If you don't like the comic, let's say you buy it, you read it, and you're like, this is shitty. Guess what? It doesn't have to count in your shitty ass content.
No.
This is probably the same kind of person that would say, but where does this fit in continuity in Killing Joke? And then if
but
you're seeing
it
this, and it doesn't really
if
fit
if you don't
in
want
there.
It to, it doesn't.
It's like, enjoy the fucking story or don't. Stop getting hung up on fucking continuity. It doesn't cheapen previous stories, you idiot. Those stories stand alone on their goddamn own.
Clearly he's read it because he says it cheapened
That's
it.
True.
So, I mean, clearly he's already read this and he already knows exactly how he has everything lined up.
Time traveler. One of three, probably.
He probably knew we were going to win too.
Scott, is this you?
Vote with your dollar, Scott. Come on.
More comic book news, this time from Dynamite. So just like DC Comics is doing acetate covers for a full month, Dynamite will be doing the same, but for one issue with Vampirella number 6, which features a Stanley Lau, aka Art Germ cover, the all-popular, I will sell the heck out of this comic because it has his cover on it, Art Germ.
You do love Art Germ. Talk about him all the time.
Really good artist. Never met him in person. I have not heard great things. I have not heard hyper-negative things either, but... His art speaks for itself.
We do have a quote here from Dynamite publisher Nick Barucci, who told Bleeding Cool, quote, "We're keeping the price at $3.99 for the series. Yes, the cost of the acetate is expensive, and we will lose money on each issue. But it's worth it to place more copies on the retailer shelves and gain more readers," end quote.
This is a bold, bold move. I don't know if anyone realizes how heavy this is. I think most readers would just say, oh, that's a cool cover. I'll pick that up. My main thing is if you're losing money on this issue and you're multiplying that by how many the retailers are ordering nationwide, worldwide, I think they should have raised this to $4.99, recouped a little bit of the loss. I honestly don't think that this issue is going to gain the readership that they think it is. I'm very nervous for Dynamite. I don't think this was a smart move by him. I think I'm going to sell this issue like crazy. And I appreciate that retailers are going to profit from it, but Dynamite isn't. I don't think anyone's going to go, well, yes, also add this to my sub. They should have waited for a number one. And that would have been a better jumping on point or an easier conversion to, because I do ask all my readers that end up picking up a number one or something that's not in their sub, hey, did you want to add this to your sub? But how many people actively do that? And how many people do that with just a rando issue? And I think it's going to be very difficult for them to gain that readership with this issue number 6.
It's a tough call because we don't know what the story is, right? Is this a new jumping on point? I don't know. I don't know anything about Vampirilla. But obviously they're putting a lot of faith into this, and I would hope that the people who made these decisions have done research behind it, right? And have something backing it up to say, yes, this will get us more readers. Maybe they made like a shit ton of profit on the others. We don't know.
Would you have ever said we're losing money on these?
No, probably not. Probably not, but he's being honest, right? And maybe by releasing that quote, like, I kind of want to subscribe just to help him out.
Maybe help out Nick.
Maybe Nick is hoping, like, people will show some compassion.
There should be a final, I don't know if Dynamite's listening, but if there should be a final page of that Vampirilla number 6, or even on the cover, like, it's just a little circle of, like, his sad face of, like, please subscribe. Yeah, how many readers would be like, all right.
Let me like, this I'm about to subscribe at least for like 3 issues, right? just to help them out a little bit.
A bit more of a positive spin to this next bit. The Guinness Book of World Records is going to be giving Todd McFarlane the title for the longest running creator-owned superhero comic book series for his creation of Spawn.
That is insane. I didn't even know that was an award.
Guinness will make all that shit possible to make headlines. And thankfully, you know, I feel it's well-earned. I do think it is well-earned. However you may feel about Todd as a person, let's be real. This has been a very successful creator-owned independent comic for him.
We do have a quote here from McFarlane who said, quote, any record that is based on longevity is made on the backs of dozens of people. As much as I am proud to be receiving this award, I gratefully accept it on behalf of all those who helped me the past 27 years on this journey, end quote.
Spawn number 1 was published in 1992, where it sold over 1.7 million copies. Goes for about, because there's so many out there, about $25. But, you know, it's not quite the first appearance, $10,000, $1,000 book that they expected it to be. A lot of these people bought multiple copies, which is why ended up being $1.7 million or copies. But it's still a very successful series. It just hit issue number 300. 301 is right around the corner. And good on Todd.
That is pretty amazing. Anytime that someone ends up in the Guinness Book of World Records, I'm always like, what can I do? Can I chew gum longer than these people?
We are the first Daniel and Kelly to win the podcast awards. We sure are. So there we go, Guinness.
Perfect.
Where's our award?
You know, off topic, right? Another world record was broken this week as well. I don't know if you saw it. You remember Usain Bolt had that running record, and I don't even remember what it was, but he had...
Bolt?
Yeah. Usain Bolt. Wasn't that his name?
Are you talking about the Disney...
No, the Olympic runner.
Oh, I know. I thought he was... I don't remember him saying Bolt, but you're talking about the grizzly bear.
No, the Olympic runner.
I'm talking about the grizzly bear story where you take the highest or fastest person in the world.
Oh.
And they can never outrun a grizzly bear.
Okay, fine. I'm talking about the Olympic runner who had a world record for running something. Okay. I don't remember. I don't know what it was. I'm sorry. I'm ignorant. But he had anyway, his world record was broken this week by a woman who gave birth 10 months ago.
That's insane. That's cool.
Insane.
That's crazy.
That's so exciting. And I don't know her name, and I'm so sorry, but she's been popping up on my Facebook. And congratulations to her to push a human being out of her body and then, like, get back to normal, even better than normal, in 10 months.
That's amazing.
Absolutely amazing. That was my story. We can continue.
It's a good story. It's a good record.
Thank you.
Very good record.
I'm going to look it up. I'll tweet about it so that I don't continue to be ignorant.
That's right. On Twitter, at PelpaKelly.
That's me.
But that does round out our news for the week. Let's head into our beginning of the month segment, which is What's New on Netflix?
Keep in mind, this is not the full list. This is just what Daniel and I are interested in, what pertains to us and to the show. You can find the full list on Google. Just search What's New on Netflix, September 2019.
I messed up on the show notes. It is October 2019.
Ooh, JK. I don't even know what month it is.
That's fine. It's a Podcast Awards quality notes.
Yeah.
Clearly.
Clearly.
Apologies, everyone. But now you know, October, you know, they know what month they're in.
That award's never going to get mailed to us now.
It got lost. So the first one on this list, it is Carmen Sandiego Season 1, a Netflix exclusive. We covered this about 4 months ago.
I'm
I thought it was out already.
I'm so excited to watch this. I'm ready. Where in time is Carmen Sandiego? Wasn't there like a game show that was Carmen Sandiego themed too?
I feel like there were several Carmen things. I was never an avid watcher of it, but I think I do want to give this a shot.
We have to. And there was like a computer game right next to like Nick's whatever, Chips Challenge. That's what it was. Did you ever play Chips Challenge?
No.
I was a boss at Chips Challenge. Not really. I got to like level 4.
Is it Nick's as in Nickelodeon?
No, it's Chips. Chips Challenge.
Okay, I thought you said Nick's.
I did say Nick's, and then I remembered his name was Chip. I think his brother's name was Nick.
Gotcha. Well, speaking of Nick, Nickelodeon's Good Burger is also hitting Netflix.
Welcome to Good Burger, home of the Good Burger. Can I take your order? That's all I remember from the movie.
I'm going to, this hit Netflix like a year or two ago, and I watched it, and I was like, all right, that was cool, and I think I want to watch it again just to have the same reaction. I liked him way more as a kid, and that's fine. But I want to watch it again, and maybe a year or two later, I'll enjoy it even more.
You should show it to Leo, see what he thinks.
Yeah, it's not a bad idea.
Yeah, we could like get a reaction video of him just sitting on the couch.
Next one on this list is Sin City, which is hailed as, right next to Zack Snyder's Watchmen, is one of the most comic accurate movie adaptations of all time.
I think I saw the second one, but I've never seen the first one.
It's a solid watch. I think you, do you like noir comics or?
I mean, I liked the second one when we watched it, okay, which I feel was kind of on par with that.
You'll really like the first one. I think the first one is more intense. It's a lot gorier, I think, but I think you will enjoy it.
We also have Superman Returns on the list.
Yeah, that does continue the, what is now dubious of, that is the definitive Superman. There's a big fight between us Snyder fans and the original 1970 Superman movie of like, which one is the actual Superman? It's like, we're going, well, this is modern Superman. This actually takes a lot of inspiration from the comics and TV shows, but there's still that back and forth push. However, Brandon Routh continued that or attempted to continue along with the rest of the team many years later. He is now returning, Brandon, on Crisis of Infinite, on Infinite Earths as Superman, which is great. And I think that even though we've dropped out of the CW shows, it might be worth watching this crossover event that is happening between all of these different shows. So if anything, good for Brandon.
If only just for Kevin Conroy. That's why we have to watch it.
Because then now he can be the best live action Batman as well as the best animated Batman.
And the final thing we have on our list is the Rugrats movie.
I think this was in 98. This is where they introduced his little brother for the first time, I think. And then they brought him over into the TV show.
Yes, I remember like there was this whole big thing and his brother was being born and it was this craziness. That's all. I just remember them like peeing. That's all.
Yeah, that's where they're in the rainforest. Is this the one with Chucky's mother or was that the sequel?
I don't
know. Oh, the sequel was the one in Paris. Yeah, that was the one about his mom. You're right. Yeah. So the first one, if you want to go back down the nostalgia track and watch some Rugrats, there you go.
Did you ever watch Rugrats all grown up when they were like teenagers?
I gave it a shot.
I did too. I watched like 2 episodes and I was done.
It was the same with Doug, which ended up being a Disney thing and it went on ABC. And it's not the first or last thing that Disney will ruin.
I didn't know they even did Doug. Didn't know that.
It was Nickelodeon first and then it got scooped up by ABC and then it became shit.
On that note, that does wrap up what's new on Netflix, what pertains to us for the month of October 2019.
Let's head into our Patreon shoutouts to people who make the show possible.
This week, we have 5 shoutouts. The first one goes out to Alexander, whose Twitter handle is at SwordfishShow. You can also find him at purpleswordfish.com.
Alexander, along with Andy, they're doing horror-themed movies for Halloween this whole month on their Dead Channel Duo podcast. If you search Dead Channel Duo on your favorite podcatcher, you will find them. Go ahead and give them a subscription. Long time Brokehead. He actually founded the word Broquette.
Yeah.
Many years ago, right here on the show. And he's got a podcast, Dead Channel Duo. And check out their podcast, in which they not only cover sports, but also movies and also gaming and a little bit of comic books. If you head on over to purpleswordfish.com, it will redirect you to his YouTube channel, where he does do live video game streams.
I just want you to know that I love you, but I will never watch horror movies with you, even for the podcast.
I was trying to think of one that you have seen in the past, and I will probably remind you later tonight of one that you're like, all right.
I already know which one it is, and I can't. It scares me. The little girl with the under the thing. No. Why would you do that to me? Now I'm not going to sleep.
Next shout out goes out to Lourdes and Katie.
I shared with Katie the Golden Girls dressed up as Disney princesses.
Yeah, what was that about? Was it like, were they GIFs or were they Photoshops?
No, they were just like pictures. Like somebody just drew them. It was some artist who decided to have fun and had them as all the different princesses. Like you had the old granny. I forgot her name.
Sophia
was Mulan, because I don't know why. But then you had Blanche as Belle. And so they had, you know, the Disney princesses, but they made the faces fit with the style. And then, of course, we still had the expressions that the Golden Girls had throughout the show. So it was really funny. I knew she would like it, being as big of a fan she is of Golden Girls. So I saw it and I'm like, gotta send it her way.
That was a good one. Yeah, she's a huge Golden Girls fan. She mm-hmm. actually has a Betty White signed photo.
That's awesome.
Years ago, she wrote in like a physical letter to the Betty White Estates or whatever it is, and sent back a signed photo, and then it has her, because she's a big animal activist, mm-hmm. of her and her pet, and signed it as both their names, which is great. So pretty awesome. Next shout out goes out to Bobby on Twitter at Cuban Slim.
Bobby ran a 38-person Pokemon League challenge at his local shop.
That is awesome. Bobby is amazing with not only Pokemon events, but Magic events, all the different gaming that he runs at his store. He is a huge help to my comic shop as well. We just had a league challenge of our own this past weekend, and unfortunately our regular judge was not able to help us out, but he provided someone who he has used in the past and someone that I've actually judged a tournament that he was participating in, which was really neat. So huge thanks to Bobby for not only being a supporter of the show, but also a supporter of everything else around us.
Our next shout out goes out to Neil, whose Twitter handle is at nmats68.
Neil was catching up on Kevin Smith's TV show called Spoilers on Hulu.
Cool.
That came out several years ago, and he was specifically watching the episode in which Mark Bernardin first did his appearance on that particular show.
I don't know who Mark Bernardin is.
He's his co-host on Fat Man on Batman, which is his regular weekly podcast. Mm-hmm. But if you have Hulu, make sure to check out Spoilers.
And our final shout out this week goes out to John, whose Twitter handle is at John72Tex, or on Instagram at Johnny2Chips.
John shared his 9.0 CGC graded copy of Strange Adventures number 205, which is the first appearance and origin of Deadman.
What is Deadman's origin?
I haven't read that issue. That is one that hasn't been reprinted in facsimile and not one that I own or have sought out.
Or have any desire to own.
The thing, Deadman's cool and all, but John shares a collection of several first appearances. Mm-hmm. If you want to check out his Instagram, he has quite a collection and some really nice stuff, including that original Bruce Timm piece of artwork of Harley Quinn. So John is truly an awesome collector. So make sure to check him out on Twitter at John72Tex or on Instagram, which is the one he updates more often, at Johnny2Chips.
And that does wrap up our Patreon shoutouts for the week. Thank you to every single one of you who contribute to help make this show possible. But even if you say, I don't have a dollar to spend to get my shout out every single month, because it's just a dollar. It's just 25 cents.
$1.
You could get your shout out less than a cup of coffee, less than a fifth of a cup of a coffee. But another great way that you can help us out is let your friends know about us. Reach out to us on Twitter at Reasons I'm Broke, at Palpakelly. Send over some questions, which we will happily read on the show.
If you want to wear some merch to help represent the Reasons I'm Broke, the award-winning The Reasons I'm Broke podcast, head on over to thereasonsimbroke.com. Click on merch. You will find a full range of t-shirts, mugs, phone cases, tapestries, all kinds of great stuff on thereasonsimbroke.com. Every bit helps and every bit goes right back into the podcast.
Do we have tapestries of our logo?
Yes.
So, yep. It's right here.
Right next to us.
So you could buy a bunch and just wallpaper your house while your wife is on vacation.
And then pretend as if it's always been there.
Yeah. And she won't kick you out.
Because then show her the show. And
yeah, and just be like, they're award winners. It's okay.
This is, our room is now cultured. Let's head into the final, or second to final segment of the show. It is our comic book highlight of the week.
As we said in the very beginning, our highlight this week is a Batman TMNT 3, number 6 of 6.
Final part of this final miniseries. It is written by James Tynion IV, with art by Freddie Williams II, and colors by Jeremy Culwell.
So full transparency, this run of Batman TMNT did not pull me in like the previous did.
Agreed.
And I thought it just got real crazy towards the end.
So they have admitted that this is going to be the final part of this trilogy arc of Batman TMNT. I don't expect to see another crossover anytime soon, or at the very least from this particular comic book team. I still want to see another Batman Adventures, but as we had the interview by John Somarriva, he said that they were focusing more on the current iteration of TMNT as opposed to the ones that they had done in Batman Adventures TMNT. So that being said, the way that they ended this particular run, it ended up being a multiverse story, which is cool. And we got some neat ideas of Batman being raised by the Turtles. But in the first arc, it was about that connection with Batman and Donatello and Raphael and Michelangelo and all the other Splinter even. And then the sequel was about the Bane Venom or Donatello being weak to not being on par with the rest of the Turtles, which I wasn't happy with because Donatello is my favorite Turtle, and it did not align with what had happened in the comics. In the comics and in the books by Eastman, they were all equally amazing, but they each had their own quirks. They had their own specialties. And in this one, in the second part, that's where I kind of had my issues with it because Donatello had this moment of fallout where he wanted to take the Venom like Batman did in the DC books, but it was more like, oh, how dare you, Donatello, instead of a moment of growth. In this third part, and it's cool, they end up doing this new universe, as I said, where Batman and the TMNT is one origin. Bruce has the pet Turtles as his parents are shot. He drops them. They go down the drain. They fall in the ooze. He follows them to try to save them and also gets raised by Splinter and the rest of the Turtles. It's awesome. It's cool. Mm-hmm. But the actual story leading into it, even with the Joker and Shredder merging, it did fall short.
The strongest part for me was that beginning part. And I think they could have wrapped it up a different way because what it ended up with is the worlds were one and they were splitting, but then we're getting people from other worlds. So you had, in total, 8 Turtles and 2 different Batmen and the Bat family. And as they're fighting the Krang, it was just too much. There was so much going on and you couldn't really focus on one point. And in addition to that, you couldn't really write one point because they had so much that they were trying to fit in there as these worlds were tearing apart, and they just kind of ended with, well, we have this whole lifetime of memories of us, but we know it's not true, so okay, bye.
That's the thing. Yes, there wasn't a universal message, and that's the biggest issue of this particular third arc. And I still recommend reading it to finish off the final part of the trilogy, but the part that I took away the most of, and I wish we had gotten more buildup of it, is that one panel that's what you said. That's exactly what I want to point out, is that the Bruce of this origin of, I know these Turtles, they're my family, I'm another brother, he's my father, and also Alfred at the same time, they retained all those memories as they were split apart and returned to their own individual memories, which was neat. It reminded me of the Inner Light in Star Trek The Next Generation, in which Picard had a lifetime of memories, and it was ended in that episode as the credits are rolling, where he's playing the flute.
Why would you bring that up again?
And that's like, I wanted that to
be... He never put away his shoes.
I know. So sad. And that's where I wanted that to end on that point. And it could have been that strong ending where at the reveal of the final page is they each retained all those memories and it would have ended there. That would have been a great cap off to both the series, even if you want to make, if you wanted to make these in continuity, because they could still fit in a way where it's like, okay, and he met the Turtles and now the story continues in the DC universe. Same with IDW, where they know each of them exist, but it wasn't really capped off in that way. Unfortunately, it was just a, all right, we made it, see you guys. And it was the end. I'm like, all right, it's tough to handle, but
they did wrap it up with Batman going back to his world with the Bat family. And he's like, let's just order some pizzas right. and be a family. I'm going to smile more. And
Gotham can rest tonight. I'm like, no, it's not Batman.
No, Batman wouldn't do that. He'd be like, okay, we're back.
Bring the pizza.
Right. You guys eat pizza. I'm going to go do shit.
Right. It is what it is. You know, it's unfortunately probably it's on par with two. I'm not going to call it the weakest of the three, but it is right there with part two. And I think part one is the strongest.
I would definitely agree with that. But like you said, finish it, wrap it up, move on with your life.
Let's head into the final part of the show. It is the Brocap Block, which is the more personal part of the podcast where Papa Kelly and I have been.
What have you been up to this week?
I had someone try to pass off a fake $100 bill at the comic shop. That was a fun one. What was funny is normally these people try to buy the cheapest thing possible with the fake $100 bill. That way they get the most change back of real currency. So this guy picked out a pop. It's always a pop when they try to buy these. Sometimes they do actually find like a cheap item, like a dice. But instead he bought a pop and I was like, hey, we're running the sale, $3 off the pops. So, and he's like, oh, let me get a second one. So I fucking upsold him on a second
one. Awesome.
So even if I had fell for it, like he would have gotten less change back, which is funny. But then he, you know, I was like, all right, here's the stamp. What's your name? I took down his name because we have a little program in the store. And he gave me his first and last name. And then he gave me the fake $100 bill. And I'm looking at it. Did he really just pass off a fake $100? And then he goes, oh, are those comics up on the wall authentic? And without pausing, I'm like, yeah, but this bill isn't. And his non-reaction immediately told me, you knew what you were fucking doing. It was a matter of, oh, my boss only pays me in cash. I should probably take a picture of that. Because I'm like, yeah, no, I can't give this back to you. And, I have a debit card in my car. I'm going to go get that and pay. And he ran off and it's like, all right, he's not coming back. I put the pops back out. To all the people that were saying, why didn't you immediately call the cops? They always run away as soon as you call the cops. As soon as you call them out, they don't come back. Oh, Mike, I got cash in the car. I'll be right back. That always happens. So the cops come out and they're like, all right, well, if he comes back, let us know. That's the reality. As long as you don't give him back the bill, that's what they appreciate. They don't want this circulating.
Right. Well, good for you. Eagle Eye Daniel.
Of all people to try this on.
Right. That always makes me laugh when, I guess it shouldn't make me laugh, but when people try to shortchange and things like that, when they try to do it to me, I'm like, you know who I am. You don't know who I am.
Or do you get the, I gave you a 20. I gave you a 50. I gave you this.
Yeah.
You get that all the time?
Not all the time, but I have gotten it before. And I always immediately, I close the drawer and I'm like, okay, I'm going to count down the drawer then. And then they're like, oh no, it was probably right. And I'm like, all right.
I haven't had people try that. And I think it's because every time I'm like out of 20, out of 10, out of 5, out of 7, like I don't care what the amount is. I always confirm with them every single time.
Good.
So I think that might be why they don't try. I don't know. That might be it. But I know it's more common in other places like maybe probably Target, Walmart, and some of those bigger box stores were just like, oh, just give them the change. And it is what it is. I'm just glad I caught that. And it was just funny to me that the line was perfect of like, why do you say he was trying to, I know he was trying to distract me, but like, what about those comics behind you? Are those authentic? Why would you ask if those are authentic? Is this your first time?
Clearly. It probably got passed off to him. So he was just trying to get rid of it.
I don't know. What about you? What happened with you this week?
I made some cold brew. I don't know.
I think you mentioned that last week. Home brewed cold brew.
You know, I worked. It was a really tough week at work, but numbers continue to go up, right? We continue to keep doing better, which is always great to see our customer survey scores, or whatever you want to call it, continue to rise. So even though we've been busier, those numbers go up, which typically you don't see. So that was exciting for me, right? On a business front, to feel like I'm making a difference, right? For everybody that I work with and the people who are coming in.
You're seeing results for the hard work you're putting in.
Right. for the exhaustion that I'm facing. But we are leading up into a little boy's birthday soon. So I've been buying him too many things, right? And planning little parties with our different families and trying to get stuff ready so that we can really celebrate him. We should be celebrating me. I'm the one who did the hard work, but whatever. We're going to celebrate him. And watching him grow, I feel like he went through, and I'm getting into Leo news, right? Because that's my favorite news. But I feel like he went through a really big shift recently. So like more development than we've really seen so far. And I've heard that from a lot of parents that I've talked to is like between 2 and 4 is when they have their biggest growth developmentally, not just, you know, with height and all that stuff, but mentally as well and doing different things. And, you know, I asked him where his toes were. I didn't even know he knew what toes were,
right.
But he knew what his toes were. And I'll ask him.
These right here.
These digits. I asked him to hand me the Game Boy today and he handed me my Game Boy Color. And I'm like, how do you know what a Game Boy is? Right. So these little things, he's starting to put things together and figure things out and being okay to play just coloring and in the quiet. And he's sleeping with a little stuffed frog now, which is just so precious. And he's trying to say things like, I love you, without me saying them first and give me hugs and all those things. So it's really cool. I've been trying to kind of detach myself from work, from my phone, all those things, and really live in these moments with him because I know they'll be gone very, very, very soon.
Yeah, I keep hearing from a lot of my regulars where they'll ask about Leo and our upbringing of our kid, and a lot of them say, I would give anything to go back to those days or to have those moments again. And you can record things, you can take pictures. It's never the same of when you're actually in the moment and you're living it. So I think as hard as one may try to encapsulate those moments and to try to make them last forever, it's always going to be a thing that every parent looks back on. If you hold any value to these moments,
of course,
of I want those days again, what I would give to have that period of time, even if it's just 1 hour. So I think that's probably a big thing why grandparents are so loving of grandchildren, because it's taking them back to those moments.
And then they have like less stress, so they can just sit there and chill and enjoy them.
Brian, if you can confirm that for us, that'd be great.
Well, my dad tells me, he was just mentioning it this morning because we went over for some coffee and he's like, Leo's like hitting my favorite age, like 2 to 5 is when kids are the most fun because they can interact with you so much and they can play so much, but they still just want to be cuddled and hugged and loved and all those things. Sometimes I try to kiss on him and he pushed me away. He's like, no, mom.
That's for my stuffed frog.
Yeah. Get out of here, mom.
That's so awesome.
Yeah.
That's really good.
That's pretty much my week. And I finally feel caught back up after all the hurricane nonsense because that knocked me out for like 3 weeks. I felt off balance. And then we all kind of caught like a half cold this last week. We never really got sick, but it was there lurking like, oh, I might sneak up on you. I might not.
Yeah, I was coughing a lot more yesterday and today it's been very minimal. I don't think I've coughed once during the show. So I think we're all getting over that.
Yep. So finally moving past that. But today was a really good day and the rest of this week is just, it's going to be awesome.
There you go. Awesome. So we hope everyone enjoyed today's episode of your now award-winning The Reasons I'm Broke podcast, forever award-winning show. So thank you all so much for tuning in, whether this is your first episode or your 368th one. Thank you so much for joining us today. I am Camper Daniel.
And I am Emperor Palpa Kelly.
And Brokehead Core.
All will be well.